this morning, I'm starting a new series that we'll be in over the next couple of weeks, simply called, How Does God Speak to Us? And there's just a real short little video to get us started. Again, talking about how does God speak to us? And in this week, we're going to be talking about understanding God's will for us in our lives and looking at different ways that God speaks to us, different avenues, different ways that God will speak and minister to us in our lives. And there's going to be four things this morning, and this isn't like this exhaustive list. There are more ways that God can and does speak to us. But this morning, there's four things that I want to share as we talk about learning how to hear God's voice, or maybe how to be more in tune with His voice, or the Holy Spirit's leading and prompting in our lives. Because if there's one thing I know, in the world we live in today, it's so busy, it's so loud, sometimes it's so hard for us to hear God's voice if we're not really intentional. We don't set aside time, if we don't block off opportunities to pray and to hear and to listen and to read and to just allow God to speak and allow the Holy Spirit to move, it's easy for us to go through a whole week and go, man, I don't think I heard God speak. But then you go, I also don't know if I gave Him an opportunity to speak. I don't know if I ever slowed down and turned off all the noise around me enough to be able to hear Him, even if He was trying to. And so my desire is, I think over these next few weeks, that each of us, maybe you're going, I've never heard the voice of God. That maybe this will be something where as we talk about this and discuss and look at Scripture, maybe for the first time in your life, you go, I know for a fact that was the voice of God speaking to me. I know that was God. And for those of us who have heard the voice of God before or heard God speak to us, and I'm not just talking audibly, I'm talking in many different ways, maybe we'll be even more in tune with the Spirit's leading and hearing God's voice for us in our lives. And maybe for some of you this sounds weird, you're going, what is he talking about hearing God's voice? Hang with me this morning. Let me walk through some scripture, because God gives us many promises in his word that we can and will hear his voice if we're willing to listen and hear him. So I want to start us off with a quick poll this morning. Would anyone be honest and raise your hand if you've asked one of the following questions? And it's going to come up on the screen behind me. Again, this isn't a judgmental thing, so I think many of us probably fall into this. Here's the questions. Does God speak to us today? Maybe you asked that question. Does he speak in an audible voice? How can I tell the difference between God and Satan? Why can't I hear God's voice? How many of you at some point in your life have asked one of those questions? Or kind of a variation of some of those questions? Right? I think most of us, if we're honest, we go, we've probably asked some of these forms of questions, and there's nothing wrong with that. Curiosity is a good thing. It leads us to study. It leads us to discover. It leads us to dig deeper into stuff we don't understand. And I understand it can be a little bit confusing if you've never felt like you've heard God's voice before. Again, as I said, I want to help us out with that throughout this series. And if you take it seriously, I believe that you'll be able to say, not only have I learned how to hear God's voice, I recognize it. I can pick it out amongst everything else, all the other noise that's going on in my life. And since we're learning how to hear the voice of God, we'll also be talking about his will, or how to know his will for our lives, learning what that means. And this morning, we're going to kind of look at that. What does it mean to know God's will for our life? Or how do we learn what that means? Maybe you hear that and you're going, that's a really Christianese term. Like, what is God's will for my life? I'm going to help you walk you through that this morning as well. And I know a couple weeks ago, I did a sermon called Life on Purpose. Because as a pastor, that's one of the questions that I get asked most frequently. What is my purpose in life? Or what is the purpose of life? People ask that question again, or a variation of that quite often. And this is another question that I get asked quite a bit is, you know, how can I hear God's voice? Can you hear God's voice? And if so, how? And what does it sound like? And all those different things. So we're going to walk through that throughout this series, because I know there's a lot of people that have some questions or maybe a little bit confused about this. God is and does speak to us still today. There's two ideas that we often find ourselves falling into the trouble of knowing, is God still talking to us today? We're going to touch on those in just a moment. But let me make it a little more practical. Maybe you haven't asked the question specifically, how do I hear God's voice? But maybe you've asked it this way. Is God's will for me to date this person, right? You have like more of a specific thing to the question. Or how do I know where I'm supposed to work? Or how do I know where I'm supposed to live, right? You're looking for direction. You're looking for answers as far as things in life. What does God want me to do with my life? Again, getting back to kind of, what is my purpose? What is God's will for my life? And again, I've asked all these questions myself. I've asked all these in more than one time throughout the course of my life. And so I want to start us off with a little bit of a story this morning from my life about a time when God spoke to me. And I believe that many of you will have stories where you can go, you know what, I remember these times when God spoke to me as well. But when I was a sophomore in college, I was going to school to become a teacher. That was what I thought I was going to do. I was going to teach history, and I was going to teach biology. That was what my plans were. I'm going to University of Wisconsin Superior thinking, yes, I'm going to be a teacher, a high school teacher. You know, excited about it, wanted to work with students, wanted to be in a position of influence. That was what I wanted, to be able to influence teenagers. I wanted to make a difference in their lives, and I thought, what a great way to be a teacher, to be a coach. Those kind of, they're very influential people in our lives as we grow up. I know many of my teachers and coaches are some of the most influential people I had in my life growing up. And so that's what I was planning on doing. And then when I got right about near the end of my sophomore year at UWS, some of you have heard this before, I was sitting in my dorm room, and God said, I'm going to use your pain for a purpose. And out loud, audibly, God spoke. In my dorm room, I'm going to use your pain for a purpose. And I went, what? I responded out loud, what? And God said it again, I'm going to use your pain for a purpose. And I kind of sat there and I was thinking to myself, what exactly does this mean? What is God trying to say to me in this moment? And if you don't know my story, I'll explain a little bit of it later to bring it all together. Because you may be going, what does he mean by my pain? And I'll explain that. But also, I'm sitting there, and I'm just kind of praying, and I'm in this moment, and I'm going, I think God just called me into the ministry. I think that's what just happened. I think God just said, I'm going to use you in the ministry, right? So I'm 2 years into my degree to become a teacher and loving what I'm doing, excited about what it is that I think I'm going to be doing. And all of a sudden, I hear this voice of God say, I'm going to use your pain for a purpose. I'm calling you into the ministry. And so what do? I call the people that I'm closest with. I call my mom and dad. I'm like, Mom, Dad, God just audibly spoke to me and said, I'm going to use your pain for a purpose. I think he called me into the ministry. And they said, yes. And I said, what do you mean? They said, we've been waiting since you were 2 years old to know that. I said, what? They said, we've known since the time you were 2 years old that you were called into the ministry. But we never wanted to put that pressure on you. We knew God would tell you when the time was right for you to be open and willing to receive that message that I had for you. Holy confirmation, right? Because you're sitting and you're kind of wondering, like, I think this is what you... No, no. When my parents told me that, it was like, okay, that's confirmation. This is what God was speaking to me, is that I'm going to use your pain. I'm calling you into the ministry. And it's like, okay. And again, I'll get back to that towards the end of my message. But I don't want you to sit here and think, whoa, is it that easy? That God just speaks out loud when you're sitting in a room by yourself and then you're going to call somebody and they're going to simply just say, yes, that's exactly what it is. It could be. God could do that, and God does do that. And I know because he did it for me in my life. And I know some of you have also heard the voice of God audibly speak to you in that way. But sometimes it's not that easy. One of the most difficult things in the world is to discern the voice and the will of God, especially if you're in a position where maybe there's no one else that's kind of discipling or leading you. Maybe you're the first person in your family to be saved. Maybe you're the only person in your group of friends or in your social circle that's interested in understanding and walking out your faith. And so sometimes it's hard when we don't have anyone there to kind of walk alongside us and help maybe go, well, this is what it looks like to hear the voice of God. This is how we can hear the voice of God and different things like that. And so sometimes it can be challenging, and that's why this morning I think it's important we take time over these next few weeks to talk about how God speaks to us. But let me be really clear this morning. Throughout your life, God will speak to you. God will speak to you. That's His word tells us that. God will speak to you if you are listening, if you're spending time allowing Him to speak. But God will speak to you. And He doesn't always do it through a big, booming, audible voice in the sky, right? You think of moments like in The Lion King where all of a sudden Simba's looking up and all of a sudden he sees the clouds move and everything. It's like this clear sound. Sometimes it doesn't look like that. Sometimes it's not this magical, clear moment where we're going, yes, that's exactly what God said. Sometimes it is. But let me be clear. God will speak to you if you're listening, if you're knowing how to listen for His voice. I think it's entirely possible that God speaks in the mundane places of our lives, and sometimes we miss it because we're so distracted by everything that's going on around us in our world. Sometimes it's just through the simple things that God speaks and is trying to lead and direct us. So this morning we're going to explore a number of different pieces of scripture. So go ahead, grab your Bibles, pull out your Bible app on your phone, whatever it may be. If you take notes, feel free to get that ready. As always, the scripture will be on the screen behind me as well. But we're going to get ready in just a moment to jump into God's word this morning. So as I said, we're going to look at four ways to hear God's voice this morning. Four different ways to hear God's voice. And we're going to look at all of these lenses through which we can hear God's voice and in that learn His will for us in our lives. So number one way that we can learn to hear God's voice is through the influence of others. Through the influence of others, we can learn how to hear God's voice. This is what it says in Proverbs 15, verse 22. It says, without counsel, plans fail, but with many advisors, they succeed. Without plans, counsel will fail. Or without counsel, plans will fail, but with many advisors, they will succeed. What does that mean? It's important for you and I to have wise counsel, to have wise advisors in our lives. Let me pause and give you some clarity again about what I'm saying this morning. I'm not saying that you have to, nor should you, listen to every single person that tries to give you advice in your life. I'm not trying to say we need to listen to what the next celebrity or the next great TV preacher or what the culture is trying to tell you to do. What I am saying is that you need to have people in your life who are rooted in God's word and who will help you and counsel you in making wise decisions in your life. We all need that. We all need wise counsel. We all need people who will give us direction and who will tell us no when we need to be told no. Sometimes that's the hardest thing for someone to do, or the hardest thing for us to receive is for someone to tell you no. But we need that. There's times in all of our lives where we need to be told no about certain things, and we need to have wise counsel around us to help. When it comes to having wise counselors in our lives, there are two major mistakes that oftentimes people make. First, we need to remember, and maybe as we get older, this one's easier, but when we're younger, we need to remember many of the greatest wise counselors in our life are our parents. And I remember as a kid, as a teenager, right, sometimes you're like, Mom and Dad, what are you talking about? You know, you don't know, you don't understand. But as you get older, you begin to learn, wow, our parents really, what they said was true. Like, we got a set of mom and daughter right here that are kind of smirking at each other, like, I think they've been through this before. You know, haven't we all? I know I was many, many times with my parents. But at some point, we learn that, you know what? They have wisdom that we don't have. The generation before us has experienced things and has wisdom that many times, as a younger generation, we maybe haven't experienced and haven't learned. And so therefore, we can learn from those who have gone before us. That we can avoid certain dangers if we're willing to say, I don't have to learn through trial and error. I can learn through just simply someone sharing, I tried this and it didn't work. And going, it's probably the same in my life. Maybe I should take their word for what it is. Right? Sometimes the second problem we face is that we put way too much stock in what our friends think. Our friends oftentimes may not always be the wisest counsel. Our friends should, but many times they may not always be the wisest counsel. When it comes to asking for wisdom, it helps to have, again, those who have been there before, those who have done that. Our friends are great, but oftentimes they can't give the best advice because, again, they haven't maybe experienced what it is that we're walking through. And so that's why it's important to be around those who have gone before us. That's why it's important that as a church, we're a multi-generational church so that the younger generations can learn from the older generations and so forth. And we learn and we feed off of one another in our experiences and we can help one another. Who you hang out with matters. Who you hang out with matters. Who you seek to give you advice matters. You wouldn't ask a 3-year-old to give you advice on dating, right? At least, I hope not. I've got a 3-year-old, and her concept of love and dating and romance is pretty hysterical, but probably not the most practical or helpful. You know, if I were to seriously ask her, right? 3-year-olds, they're not wise on that topic of dating and love and those kind of things. They haven't experienced it yet, at least you hope not. You wouldn't ask an atheist about advice on growing in your faith. Why? Because they don't have a relationship with Christ, so you wouldn't go to them and ask them for help and how to grow in your relationship with Christ. I hope you get the point this morning. Again, in Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20, it says this, whoever walks with the wise becomes wise, but the companions of fools will suffer harm. We walk with the wise, we become wiser. When we become companions of fools, it says we will suffer harm. Think about that for a moment. Who we hang out with matters. Who we seek advice from matters. If you hang out with wise people, you'll begin to see the fruit of their wisdom begin to take place in your life. If we spend time with foolish people, then it shouldn't surprise us if we continue to find ourselves falling into foolish situations. If your life is in a spot right now where you're going, I never thought I'd find myself in a mess like this. Maybe you need to look around and see the people that you've surrounded yourself with. Because maybe that's a part of the challenge you find yourself in at this time. Who we seek help from is important. I want you to check out this video this morning that's going to help drive home this point. So Larry, if you'd like to shut the lights off. This is about a 2.5-minute video of an interview with a 3-year-old.
What's your name?
Cough.
What's your favorite cartoon?
Monsters University.
Monsters University?
Yeah.
Who's your favorite character on Monsters University?
Sully.
Sully?
Yeah.
Who else is in that movie?
Master
Sowski. Mm-hmm. I've been thinking about buying a Ford F-150, but I just can't get past the idea that maybe a GMC Sierra is better. Which truck do you think should do? All right. Well, I was also looking at my stocks and bonds this afternoon, and it just looks like my stocks are plummeting. What do you think I should do? I really been meaning to ask you this serious question. I feel like sometimes God hears my prayers and sometimes he doesn't. But then I'm all like, you know, praying stuff that I know he knows that I know, but then I don't know if he knows that I know. That he knows?
Yeah.
Who's gonna win? The Broncos or the Seahawks?
The Seahawks win.
Let's turn it off. Okay. I will give you the popcorn back when you answer this question correctly. Who is the best quarterback to ever play in the NFL?
Peyton Manning.
Alright. You can have your popcorn back now. Don't get that one wrong again. Kipton?
What?
How do I know what God's will is?
I don't know.
Why don't you know? I thought you knew. Who's better looking, Daddy or Jared?
Jared.
Are you pre-millennialism or post-millennialism?
I want clean.
That's what I thought.
Again, that video, you know, it's fun, it's cute, but yet it's giving the point across too of it's important who we seek counsel from. It's important who we seek wisdom from it. And maybe it's not as drastic as a father asking his three-year-old questions about stocks and bonds and what vehicle he should buy and whatnot like that. But yet, I know there's been times in my life where I've sought counsel from someone and then I look back and I think, why did I seek it from that person? They've never experienced it. They've never been through what it is I'm asking them about. And it's kind of like it was as good as asking a three-year-old child for that help. And so who we hang out with, who we seek counsel from in our lives matters. When we choose to spend time with wise people who love God, we can hear God's voice through their words and the examples they set for us. So we can learn through the influence of others. Number two, we can learn how to hear God's voice through life situations. Through life situations that we go through in our lives. There are some things about your life that you can't change. Right? The past is the past. It can't be changed. There's nothing we can do about our past. Right? You can't change your family. Can't change the sound of your voice. Can't change your DNA. There's all these things that we can't change in our lives. And I want you to know that in all of this, God has a plan for you. Even if you wish you could change it. Even if you wish you could go, God, I wish my voice was different. I wish the plan you had for my life was different. We can't change it. And God uses your life situations to reveal himself to you, even the difficult ones. And oftentimes, sometimes the greatest ways he speaks to us is through the difficult things we experience in life. Right? If we look at the first book of the Bible in Genesis, we're not going to actually look at any specific passages, but the story of Joseph. Right? Joseph didn't choose to be sold into slavery by his brothers, but it happened. He didn't choose to be thrown into jail, but it happened. He didn't choose to be wrongfully accused, even though he made the right decisions. But Joseph made the decision that he was going to allow God to change his attitude about the tough things that were happening to him. He's going, I can't change any of these things, but what I can change is my attitude. I can change my response to the difficult things he's found himself going through. And maybe this morning you're sitting here and you're going, I'm in a difficult life situation right now. I want you to know that God isn't up in heaven just pressing a button that's going, make their life fall apart. Make their life fall apart. He's not doing that. God isn't hitting a button to make your life fall apart. The reality is we live in a broken world full of sin, and as a result of that, there are challenging, difficult things that we have to endure in this life. Maybe this morning you're sitting here and you go, you know what, I'm actually even upset at God right now. I'm frustrated with God for what he's allowing me or my family to experience in this moment. I understand that I've been there. And again, I'll get to that a little bit later in the message. One of the things that I've learned is that God doesn't always just swoop in and fix everything, especially not in a moment. As much as I wish that there are certain circumstances in my life that God could have changed, he didn't. And I had to learn that throughout those hard times, throughout those difficult situations, it wasn't God that needed to change. It wasn't the situation that needed to change. It was me who needed to be willing to be changed through the situation that I was walking through. Instead of God changing my circumstance, I had to choose to let God change my perspective, change the way that I was looking at it. And I've got a couple of examples of what a new perspective might sound like. They'll be on the screen as well. First one, I can't change my life situation, but I'm going to choose to change my attitude and focus on what I can change. My attitude, my outlook, my perspective. Secondly, I can't change what's happened to me, but I know God can redeem it and use it to help me grow and to help me serve other people. God can redeem it and help me grow, help you grow, and help use it to serve other people for the kingdom of God. And another way our perspective can change is I can't change what I'm going through, but I know God is with me in the midst of it, and that is enough. Knowing that God is with us in the midst of everything, even when it's challenging, that is enough. As I've walked through difficult times in my life, there's been times where I've hated some of the things I've had to deal with. I've been frustrated with God. Sometimes I didn't know what to say. And I look back, and now that I've allowed God to change my perspective, I'm glad that I went through the things I went through. But I do know that I am who I am today because of the experiences that I went through before. The life situations have helped me to hear and understand God's voice and to hear and understand God's will for my life through the different things that I have experienced, and I know the same is true for many of you. Maybe you've experienced something that wasn't fair in your life. I hope you know that you're loved. You are welcomed here. And we are always willing and available to talk to you, to meet with you, to provide whatever type of care and ministry we can, and know that you do not have to walk through anything alone. No matter what it is, you don't need to try to walk through it alone. So we can learn through the influence of others. We can learn through a life situation. And third, we can learn how to hear God's voice through the leading of the Holy Spirit, through allowing the Holy Spirit to lead, direct, to speak to us in our life. First off, I definitely want to mention the other ones are important. This one and the next one are of utmost importance. The Holy Spirit is a gift that God promised to us, and Jesus tells us that in John chapter 16. We're going to look at a little bit of what Jesus was teaching the disciples in John chapter 16 as he was preparing them that he was going to have to go and that God would send the gift of the Holy Spirit. Says this starting at verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For some reason my thing shut. For if I do not go away, the helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment, concerning sin because they do not believe in me. Concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father, and you will see me no longer. Concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. And then if we continue reading, it says, I still have many things to say to you. Again, Jesus speaking, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, speaking of the Holy Spirit, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. So Jesus is telling, he's teaching the disciples about the Holy Spirit who's going to come. I think many times we look at this and we kind of treat the Holy Spirit like kind of just the third wheel in the Trinity of God. And sometimes we look at him and we go, he's the most underappreciated gift that we find in all Scripture. The Holy Spirit empowers us. The Holy Spirit enables us. The Holy Spirit is the one who gives us the ability to be a light in our world around us. So if we're not allowing the Holy Spirit to work and function in our lives, dare I say, we're failing. We are failing as believers if we're not allowing the Holy Spirit to enable, empower, and equip us to reach the world around us. Scripture tells us that the Holy Spirit dwells inside us at the moment that we are saved. He becomes our helper, our guide, our comforter, and the one who convicts us of our sin and empowers us to live a faithful and holy, righteous life. How many of you know that there's times where the Holy Spirit kind of gives you a nudge? right? Gives you that kind of little nudge, that little push. And sometimes maybe it feels like, you know, that little nut, you know, in your gut, you kind of get a feeling or a hunch, different things. Many times that's the Holy Spirit speaking and ministering and trying to move in your life and encouraging to serve someone or be obedient in one specific way or another. As you grow in your relationship with God, you will learn to discern the voice of the Holy Spirit more and more in your life. And in John 14, again, Jesus is telling the disciples about the Holy Spirit. Verse 26, he says, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you." He will remind the disciples, he'll remind us all that Jesus has said in his word. I want to share another little story, a little personal story. Just before Christmas, I was out on a daddy-daughter day with Gabriella, which we do every Wednesday following gymnastics in Virginia. We typically go out to the village inn, or as she likes to call it, the green roof, because it has that green roof around it. So, hey, Gabriella, where do you want to go for lunch? I want to go to the green roof. Okay, are you sure? Yeah, I want to go to the green roof. Okay, honey, that's kind of become our place. But anyhow, it's like the week before Christmas, or maybe 2 weeks before, and we enjoyed our meal and our time together, and all of a sudden, I just sense the Holy Spirit going, "Remember that $50 bill that's in your pocket that somebody gave to you? I want you to leave that on the table for a tip to this waitress." And it's kind of like, okay. And all of a sudden I kind of felt that nudge again. "I want you to leave that tip on this table for this waitress." And so I said, "Okay, God. Okay, listen to the Holy Spirit." And then I took that $50 bill and I left it on the table, and we kind of hurried over to check out. You know, I was trying to kind of get out of there as quick as we could. And I'm sitting there and I'm paying for our meal, and the waitress walks over and she sees it. And we're trying to get out the door, and she literally kind of yells in the restaurant. And so I turn around and she said, "Sir, did you make a mistake? Did you put the wrong bill down on the table?" I said, "No, ma'am, I didn't. I just felt like God told me I was supposed to leave this for you as a Christmas blessing." And she began to cry. Tears filled her eyes. And she said, "You have no idea how difficult this Christmas season has been for us." And it's in those moments like that, like, I don't say that to share what I did. That's when the Holy Spirit nudges you and you respond. Those are the kind of Holy Spirit moments that happen. People's lives are impacted. I've seen that lady multiple times since, and we've never had a conversation about her or anything, but God planted a seed in that lady's heart and in her mind that day through simple obedience of someone being willing to listen to the nudging of the Holy Spirit and be obedient to what it was they were being asked to do. And man, it was a cool teaching moment for my daughter too, to be able to explain it, because she didn't understand what was happening. She didn't understand why that waitress got so emotional in that moment. And so as a parent, it was a cool opportunity to be able to share with her as well about saying, you know what? Sometimes God impresses something on our heart, and we have to be obedient. And it's those are the teaching moments where, as a parent, man, it doesn't get any better than that. So to recap, we've talked about three different ways we can hear God's voice. First, God works or speaks through the influence of others. God can speak through our life situations. And third, he speaks through the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And what's interesting about these three is that sometimes they can be hard to discern. They can be hard to hear or understand at times. Sometimes we don't know who we should be learning from, right? We have to remember who we hang out with, who we seek advice from, counsel is important. Sometimes we misinterpret a life situation. We find ourselves in a difficult spot. We go, "Oh, God's trying to teach me this." And maybe we just misinterpret what it was that God was trying to teach us in that moment, in that situation. Maybe we even think that the Holy Spirit is leading or nudging us to do something, and we realize after we follow through, we go, "Oh, that I don't think that was actually the Holy Spirit. Maybe it was just your own idea," or whatever it is. Sometimes we can mishear or misunderstand these different things. And if you have, that's okay. I have too. There's nothing wrong with that. Our job is to be obedient, but that's why it's important that we learn how to hear and discern the voice of God and the Holy Spirit in our lives. But there's one more big lens through which we need to look to see the previous three. To be perfectly clear, what I'm about to tell you about is the number one way that you can absolutely hear from God. that you can learn God's will for your life, and you can interpret the situations you find yourself in. And the beauty of this one is it's solid, it's unchanging, it's perfect, it's without error. We hear God's voice, number four, through the Word of God. Through His Word. That's how we hear the voice of God. The Bible is the absolute easiest way for us to hear the voice of God. I know there's been times where I'm reading Scripture, and you can read that same Scripture over and over and over again, and all of a sudden one day, God just speaks something different about it. The Holy Spirit illuminates a truth about it. Why? Because God's Word is living and active. It's sharper than any double-edged sword, splitting bone and marrow from one another. It's living. It's perfect. I know what you're thinking. Well, this is your message every week. We need to read our Bibles. Yeah, absolutely we do. If we're not reading our Bibles again, we are missing it. It's important. It's practical. It's a part of our walk with the Lord. I've heard people ask me over and over again, how can we learn God's will? And it's a great question. If we know God's will, it allows us to walk it out in a truly God-honoring way. I'm here to tell you that God has spoken through Scripture, and God is still speaking through Scripture today in 2022. Every time I read the Bible, God allows me to learn something new about what is happening right now in my life that applies to where I find myself in my life. That maybe 10 years ago in my early 20s, it wouldn't have made any sense or wouldn't have applied or would have looked different. And now in my early 30s and just some of the things I've experienced, it's, well, that Scripture has a whole different meaning to me. There's a whole different context. There's a whole different understanding to that Scripture because I've experienced what that Scripture is talking about. Romans 12, verse 2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. We renew our minds by spending time in God's word and prayer. We renew our minds where we remind ourselves that He is the King and that we are to submit ourselves under Him over and over and over again. We learn about Him and how He created us as we spend time in His Word. It's in these moments, it's in these times that we're in God's Word that God shows us how important it is to spend intimate time reading His Word so that we can know His will. It's written right before us. We just have to take the time to read it, to be in it, to digest it, to spend time listening. Earlier I shared with you about how I was called into ministry during my sophomore year of college and the challenge that it was, right? So I want to kind of back up behind that. If you don't know my story, here's how I got to the point that I did, right? So I'm going to college at University of Wisconsin-Superior, pursuing a secondary education degree to become a teacher. And I was only going to that college because one reason. The plans I previously had for college went away when my brother died my senior year of high school. I had a plan. I had a track for my life. I was going to go to the University of Northern Michigan. I was going to become an engineer, mine engineer, and I was going to work in the mines. That's what my brother did. He was my role model. That was what I was going to do. And the moment that he died, that dream died. So that's how I ended up in the situation that I was in. That wasn't my plan. That wasn't where I thought I was going. I thought I knew what I was doing up until October 12, 2006, my senior year of high school. That day, everything changed. While I was at UWS, God helped me find a young adult small group at a church called the River Church, formerly called Glad Tidings. Some of you may know of it. This young adult group became the safe place where, in the midst of my struggles, I could go. I could find healing. I could find people who could comfort and give me wise counsel, who could give me some direction. And the crazy thing is, the guy who was leading that young adult group had been through many crazy things in his life. Not the same things I had, but he had overcome a lot of difficult situations. And he had been through things that were able to help me get through the struggles that I was walking through at that time in my life. Through both my parents' confirmation of my calling into the ministry, which I mentioned earlier, and the encouragement of this young adult small group leader that I was able to spend time with, I confidently knew this is what God was calling me to do. This was God's will for my life. Through spending time in His Word, through allowing the Holy Spirit to speak, through allowing life situations to help shape and teach me and help me understand God's voice, and allowing those around me who had wise counsel to counsel me, to help me know what decisions to make, to help me know what direction my life was headed. Right? You see how it worked? God simply didn't just speak audibly to me in that dorm room and just leave it right there. He spoke to me in that dorm room audibly, and then he used my parents to confirm it. He used a small group leader to help speak confirmation and help speak wisdom and counsel into my life. I was plugged into a local church, and being there, I was able to allow the Holy Spirit to speak and minister and to spend time in God's Word, learning how to hear and once again discern the voice of God through the hurt, through the pain, through the frustration that I had in my life. Now, I know that sounds like, oh, this is all about a big commercial for church. In some ways, yeah, it is. It's important. The fellowship, the community, the family that a local church is so important. But my goal here is to say this, that you can invite God into every situation in your life. Every situation you can invite God into. And if you're listening, he'll give you direction through different sources, through different ways. It could be through the influence of others. It could be through the situation you find yourself in. It could be through the Holy Spirit nudging and leading you to do something. And most definitely, it's through looking and being in the Word of God and allowing him to speak. It's possible that you might be telling a similar story 15 years from now than maybe I did. Not the same details, but maybe you found yourself in a difficult place, in a difficult situation, and down the road you're able to look back and go, I wasn't grateful for it in the moment, but man, am I grateful for everything I've experienced, because it has me where I'm at today. It has me the young man that I am today. How you go to college, how you take a job, how you meet that specific person, where you go, allow God to speak and lead and direct all those different things in your life. I want to say this. It's 100% your decision to lean into hearing God's voice. Yours and yours alone. People can speak to you. If you're not listening, you're not going to hear it. You can be going through life situations where God's trying to speak to you and lead you, and you're not looking, and your perspective is distorted in one way or another, and you're not learning. The Holy Spirit could be nudging you in some way and trying to lead you, and you're just oblivious to what the Holy Spirit's doing. And maybe you're just avoiding God's Word. Maybe you're not spending time in it, or you're just kind of, well, I opened my Bible up today, I looked at the verse of the day, my streak just went up one more day. Right, kind of just checking the box of, well, I hit the Bible today. It's 100% your decision to lean into listening to God's voice in your life. But I don't want you to think that it will just come booming out of the sky one day. Again, it could. God can, and he has. But you need to pursue God by spending time in his Word, by allowing the Holy Spirit to speak, and by allowing congregation with brothers and sisters in Christ at church to be a priority in your life. I want to end on this point. Pastor Bethany, you can come up. It's incredibly important that you learn to hear God's voice on your own. So many people will declare that they are Christ followers or Christians, but so many of them cut themselves short when it comes to this area of Christianity. The whole basis for our faith is that we have a relationship with God. If we don't pay attention to God's voice, again, I beg this question, what are we even doing? If we're not listening for God's voice, listening for the Holy Spirit to speak and direct, what are we even doing? We're missing it. And that's why it's important. The whole basis of our faith is that we have a relationship with God. We need to pay attention. We need to hear his voice. We need to allow the Holy Spirit to speak. I hope this message has encouraged you this morning, and maybe for some of you challenged you. As always, if you have any questions, I want you to know, you can always feel free to ask myself, ask Pastor Laura, ask Pastors Bethany or Brad, ask one of us what questions you may have. And I'd love to follow up and dig deeper into maybe a question or a thought you have from this morning or just in general. This stuff isn't common to each and every person. It's like somebody walking around on the street that doesn't know the Lord isn't going to be concerned or thinking about hearing the voice of God. But today I want you to go, am I being intentional about listening for the voice of God in my life? Don't give yourself a hard time if this is your first time that maybe you've heard about it or you're spending time listening for God's voice. We all had a first time. We all had a first time, and then we move forward and we listen. We're intentional. I'm excited for what the next couple weeks are going to look like as we continue to dig deeper into the series about how God speaks to us. It's important that we continue to remember that the voice of God, the leading of the Holy Spirit, and God's Word is so prevalent to us today still, because it's living, it's active, and it's our source of life. It's what leads us, guides us, and directs us. And so this morning, we're going to have just a short time of just reflection, or maybe even to just sit and listen. As Pastor Bethany leads us, to just listen and allow the Holy Spirit to speak. Maybe there's something God put on your heart to share with somebody else this morning. And maybe this is an opportunity for you to allow the Holy Spirit's nudging and you be obedient and go speak. And I want to encourage, if God is asking you to do that, please do it. And if someone comes up to you, please be receptive to what it is that they have to say. Because we're going to allow a moment here for the Holy Spirit to speak and lead and direct. Or maybe this morning you need to just take a few moments and you need to just pray and say, God, help me to just hear and sense and understand your voice in the midst of everything else going on. And lastly, if you're in that tough situation in life, maybe you need to say, God, help change my perspective. Help change the perspective that I currently have about what I'm walking through, so that it may be used to help me grow and to help you use it to serve the kingdom of God better. And so we're going to take just a few minutes and allow the Holy Spirit to minister this morning. If you'd like prayer, I'll be off to the side. Our altars are open, and then we'll close together in just a few minutes. Father, we just thank you this morning for this reminder from your word of four different ways, God, that you speak to us in our lives still today. In the midst of the busyness, in the midst of the chaos, in the midst of the unrest that's not just in our country, but throughout our whole world, God, you are still speaking, you are still moving, God. People are still being saved, and the kingdom of God is continuing to grow and advance each and every day, and we thank you for that this morning. But Father, I just pray that as, again, we've been reminded this morning of four different ways, God, that you speak to us, and we can hear your voice and hear your leading and learn how to discern your will for our lives. God, I just pray that we wouldn't just hear it and maybe write it down, but God, that we would apply it in our lives. That we would say, who are the people in my life that I'm allowing to be my counsel? Who are those who I'm allowing to influence my decisions and help me navigate through the different places I find myself in life? Am I wandering and walking with wise counsel that's helping me make wise decisions? Or maybe do I need to reevaluate those I'm with because maybe they're leading me to make foolish decisions and finding myself just kind of treading and in difficult spots? Lord, I pray that for those, God, who maybe find themselves in life situations that are particularly difficult right now, Lord, I pray that you would help them to have a perspective that, God, they would see what you are trying to do in the midst of the situation they find themselves in. Or, God, maybe even if they're already removed from it, God, that they would be able to reflect back and say, God, I now see, I now know what it was that you were trying to teach me in those moments in that situation. And, God, I thank you for that. I pray we would have that heavenly perspective, that eternal perspective, that we would allow you to lead and direct and guide us. God, I pray that we would be believers who are empowered, equipped, and enabled by the working of the Holy Spirit to continue to be a light and a witness to those around us. That we would allow the Holy Spirit to speak in our lives and speak through our lives. When you place those nudges or you give us a prompting to do something, I pray we would be obedient. I pray we would be faithful and we would follow through with what it is you are asking us to do, and just allowing you, God, to minister, to speak, to lead, to guide, to direct in those moments. And I pray, Lord, that we are spending time in your living word, that we are being transformed, that we are hearing from you, your voice through your scripture that you wrote thousands of years ago, but God, still today it's moving and active and living, and it has all power and all authority. It's without error. It is perfect from beginning to end. God, I pray that you would help us again to just be able to discern your voice, to hear your voice, to spend time being intentional and allowing opportunities for you to speak to us. God, that we would be intentional about gathering together with the saints, with the community of believers around us, that we would continue to encourage, continue to build relationships, and continue to allow you to speak in and through those relationships and in and through our times together. Father, I just pray as we go now again that we would hear your voice, that we would see your prompting, that we would see even in the midst of the mundane the things you are speaking and wanting to do in our lives today. We just praise you and worship you. We ask, God, that you go before us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Drags me into one more day.